Yo, what's good, YouTube? This is Jay from TNJ, and we are back for the Lions franchise heading into season 9 now. And just leading off of last episode, we went through season 8, and we kind of ran into a dilemma with Justin Fields. Now, we won one playoff game last season, and now we have a chance to negotiate another contract with him. And quite frankly, I am just going to probably franchise tag him. I think that makes the most sense right now. And just looking at this, I'm just going to lowball offer him so he declines it. And then I do get the franchise tag option. So hopefully he does not accept this. Yeah, it looks like he's testing free agency. So we will put the franchise tag on him, keep him with us, because it just doesn't make sense to kind of have a long-term type of deal with him. I mean, he is one of the best quarterbacks in the league right now, but I think we could do better. And I think one of the things with him is just that he doesn't put up the big numbers when there is simulation, and that's one of the things I do want to address. I'm not sure why Anthony Ng keeps coming up as being a free agent, because I do keep re-signing him to new contracts. One guy I do want to get signed here is Reed Watts. Now, he is demanding a three-year $15 million deal. We have about $24 million in cap room, but I think I have to let him walk right now and try to get him in free agency, but I do want to keep him around, so let's just advance to free agency, see who's there. All right, $28 million in cap, and we don't have a lot of leverage with a lot of our players right now. We pretty much signed a lot of big deals last 2 years ago, the year we signed Rich Patton and all those guys. And now this free agency class doesn't look impressive. Now, one position I do need to address is defensive end, because after signing Trey Flowers last offseason, he has retired. So now we sit here and we need to get another star at defensive end. And I'm looking at Derek Swift here. I'm not sure why he declined here. It's maybe because of his morale, but he is really good. And look at his block shedding, 90. Play recognition, 85. I think this is our guy to go after. We're just going to offer him kind of a bigger deal. Now, this will take up a lot of our cap, and really, we need to do it because we do not have a ton of leverage with a lot of other guys. So let's just see if we get him. How about bringing back our old pal Taylor Decker, as he might return to the Lions? He's only asking for a one-year, $3 million deal. And that's really all we need. We kind of just need a stopgap tackle, maybe have a year to develop our backup tackle. I'm not sure what a tackle is going to look like in free agency or in the draft. So we need to go here and just get a older veteran and sign him to a cheaper deal. So it looks like Decker and Sanchez both accepted their offer, but Swift did not. So we'll need to address left end again. So Swift ended up signing with the Seattle Seahawks. So that kind of limits what we have to do now, because now we have to go after a cheaper, probably a less talented option. And Yetur Gross-Matos is still there, so we might just re-sign him to a one-year deal, as he might actually be our starter now after he's been the backup for all of this time. And it does make sense to bring him back. Just looking at, you know, just the development we've had with him, he's only 73 overall and he's 28 years old. I think I'm going to look between these two guys, Willis Clayton and Yetur. Let's just look at Willis Clayton really quick. He is 73 overall. He's got 85 power moves, so that's actually really good. And he's a year younger. And looking at Yetur, it looks like he's actually the inferior talent here. Willis Clayton, a year younger, it makes a lot of sense on a one-year deal. Let's just do this and sign Willis Clayton to a one-year deal. So heading into the draft, really our biggest needs are just finding a future at defensive end to pair with Bryant Ryan. And we did draft Earl Monroe last year. I am intrigued by seeing him develop and seeing how he will grow. And he's got 83 power moves. He's pretty good for a young guy. He's only 23 too, so I don't want to give up on him at all. But then at defensive tackle, we do have Jordan Nesvisky, who did have a fifth year option and we actually did decline it. And the reason why we declined it, because I'm not looking to keep him around. More than likely I might look to trade him at the deadline, get something good for him, and let's see if we can kind of build another juggernaut defense, because now we're missing our two stars of this series in Big Play Slay and also Trey Flowers. And then we also developed our own stars with Rich Patton and Jelani Tavai, who's been here. He's now 30 years old. I mean, These guys are aging now. So looking at cornerback, we're actually thin here as well. We have only three cornerbacks on the roster, so we'll need to go heavy in the draft there. All right, notable signings leaving our team. Reed Watts does replace Blake Martinez with the Green Bay Packers after all of these years. So he will get a new start with a divisional opponent. Trey Adams moves over to the Raiders. We only had him at tackle for a couple of years. And then Kerryon Johnson, our old friend, he goes over to the Chargers. I was actually debating bringing him back. I probably should have now that I look back at it. He is still pretty good, 79 overall at 30 years old. Also, Henry Ruggs had a short stint with us. He now moves over to the Jacksonville Jaguars. All right, so at the NFL draft, let's just see who goes number one overall. And it looks like it's going to be Will Miner, a defensive tackle out of Stanford. And we will look at the ratings a little later, but our pick is at pick 26. So now at pick 26, and I do have an interesting tackle here, and I did want to address the future at left tackle. He is a mid-first round talent, Morris Thomas. He looks pretty good, to be honest. And let's just look at some other positions here that we did want to kind of address. Will Knowles out of Colorado State is a late first round talent. He is 21 years old. That is very, very intriguing. And I did just draft an end last draft, I know, but getting another one with his type of talent would be amazing. Now, Troy Richards, 24, though, he's a first-round talent. But Will Knowles, I mean, he's 21 years old. I think that's the most intriguing thing about it, is that he's 21, so I will have a lot of prime years with him. But I think that drafting a tackle here is probably the thing that should make the most sense here, because like I said, you do need to draft offensive linemen. That's been the bread and butter, and that's the reason why we've been so successful here in this series. But I'm not going to do it, because I think that passing up on Will Knowles as a late first round talent at 21 years old, you just don't see this type of athleticism from an end every year. So let's just go with him. And he ends up being hidden dev trait. So we did make the good decision going with him. Hidden dev, it looks like he's got high finesse moves and he is going to be special. I'm so glad that we just took that risk. So now we have some talent at left end. So look who falls to the second round. It is Morris Thomas. He is still available here and he is a first round talent, fourth round projected. And I am going to draft him, so we will get a little lucky here and get both of the guys we were asking for. And he is number 12 in true talent. Wow, that's really, really good. And look at this. I mean, we got a steal here in the second round. So these two guys will be the future of this team. So third round, I'm really just going for BPA here, best player available. And I'm just looking at all the guys that we did scout, and there's only one guy that's a third or a second round talent here, and it's Michael Hunt, and he is pretty good, 23 years old. I have no problem getting this, picking him here, even though he has an early sixth round projection, because like I said, we're not re-signing Nesvisky, and it looks like we did get good value out of him. Draft him at 59. He's number 90 inch out of 90, actually. 59 out of 90. Actually, really good. I don't mind this pick. I think we have time to develop him. So here in the fourth round, I want to double up on defensive tackle. We don't have much depth here. And I'm looking at an early third round talent here in the fourth. I think it's a good pick. Even though he's drafted, projected to be drafted in the seventh, and he ends up being William Stevens, and he is a defensive tackle out of Oklahoma State, 23 years old. We are getting really good value out of all of our draft picks this draft. Another good pick for the Lions. Another pick here in the fourth round, and I'm looking at a seventh round projected cornerback here. I don't expect him to be ultra talented, just to be a guy to just have as a depth guy. 64 overall, Jaden McCann out of Arkansas. He's 22, only 5'9", though. He's got speed, but his coverage ratings definitely need work. Now, the last guy I will show here is our last pick here, and it's in the fifth round. I'm going to go with a quarterback, and I'm just going to go after the most athletic guy with the highest combine grade, and I'm going with Greg Kendricks, only 5'11", out of Washington. Let's just see how good he is, and he is not good, 57 overall. Pretty good athleticism, but he's just going to be a backup. And him and Anthony Ying will definitely be the backups to Justin Fields. So quick draft recap. Morris Thomas ends up being our best overall player picked in this draft. This was a very good draft for us. I really like the picks of Michael Hunt and Will Stevens as well. Those guys will definitely compete in the future for that starting job and just give us some much needed depth there. And then Will Knowles is also a great piece to develop. Can't wait to see what these guys do. All right, season 9, new left end and a big future, new left tackle. And it looks like we are probably playing the AFC West. So it looks like we play the Broncos, Chiefs, and Raiders, and also the Chargers right in the middle. And then who else we play? We play also the NFC West, it looks like. Cardinals, 49ers, and I thought I saw... Okay, there's the Rams. And who am I missing here? The Seahawks. There we go. So it looks like we're playing the NFC West and the AFC West. This is going to be probably a tough schedule since all of these teams are really, really good. So let's get into the season. Before the start, Will Knowles does have an upgrade. I'm going to upgrade his run stopper to just get him to be more of an all-around left end. He goes up in +3 in block shedding, and it looks like he is going to be pretty good to start it out. 72 overall, 80 finesse move, 75 block shed, that goes up +3. So let's get into the first game. Good start to the season for your Lions. 411 total yards. Raiders only got 282, and they do have Jordan Love at quarterback. But Justin Fields threw a touchdown and two interceptions. Kennedy Brooks ran for 68 yards. Keon Knight gets a touchdown, his first of the year, obviously. And then TJ Hockenson also grabs 5 for 67. Now, how did we get that many offensive yardage? And we actually only won by 4 points. So we must play some good defense. Let's see. So Jordan Love did throw an interception. I wonder who did catch that interception. And it looks like it was Rich Patton, the best defensive player we have. And then James Anderson added 3 sacks. Wow. And Rich Patton had 1.5. And then Michael Hunt had a sack, the rookie. So good start to his career. The next two games we do end up splitting before the bye week in week 5. We play the Rams this coming week, but we do beat the Buccaneers 35-27. And then we lose to the Packers. Let's just look at this win. In another big offensive game, Justin Fields with a good bounce back game over D Bird, throwing 4 touchdowns. I wonder who those went to. Kenny Brooks looks like he's running the ball well out of the gate. Keon Knight and TJ Hockenson both have 2 apiece. That should be the formula every single game. Get those two the ball. Those guys are unstoppable. And then we lose to the Packers. And let's just see how our offense did. Remember, their quarterback by Sam Ellinger. But look at this. Justin Fields continues to throw interceptions, showing some inconsistency here. And that's why I did not want to sign him to a long-term deal. Kind of wanted to keep him franchise tagged. And he threw 3 interceptions. Let's see who caught them. And it looks like Jair Alexander caught 2 of them. And he is probably close to 28 years old now. So another upgrade for Will Knowles after the first few games of the season. Let's just keep getting this run stopper up because I want to get that block shedding up. Let's see, his overall did not go up, but his block shed went up 1, +2 in pursuit, +1 in play recognition. So didn't jump up overall, but at least his attributes are rising, and I am excited to see what he is. He's progressing pretty fast, so it makes me think that he might be superstar trait. Now, Morris Thomas, the rookie, also has an upgrade, and he is starting at left tackle. Let's upgrade that power. He goes up to 76 overall himself. Run block power goes up, and I am looking forward to these guys developing into the future stars of this team. All right, we lose the next game. So going into the bye week, I am going to address this contract with Keon Knight. Let's just see what our cap situation is looking like. We have plenty of it. We have 81. I thought we had a lot less than that. And he is a captain. I'm going to give him what he wants and a little bit more just to make sure he does commit. I would hate to franchise tag him. And I think that 4 years, $73.8 million is more than enough. And I think he will accept this. Let's just give him a little bit more of a bonus. 4 years, $74 million to be exact. And let's lock him up, and he will be locked up. So Keon Knight, our future and our present at receiver, he is locked up. Now, Quinn Bryant is an important part of this offensive line. I think it is very pivotal for us to re-sign him. So let's overpay our guys a little bit. 3 years, $36.9 million. I think that's good enough to keep him to age 31, and he will re-sign. So two of our guys re-signed right there. Now, Ollie Gray, I'm surprised he's even due for a contract extension here. Bryant Ryan, I think I'm going to sign Bryant Ryan first, but Ollie Gray is the only one that's eligible, actually. So $24 million over 5 years is not bad at all. It ends up being a little bit more than that $45 million. I don't know why it said 25. That must have been without the bonus. So let's just try to get him as close to what he's asking as possible. And it looks like he will decline that, so we will have to renegotiate later. After the bye week, we barely get another win, defeating the Minnesota Vikings by two. And a lot of these victories have been close. Justin Fields has pretty much thrown an interception in every game except one. That's kind of concerning, as I don't know what the problem is right there, but it just seems like he's been just inconsistent throwing the football. Our defense is doing pretty well at this point. I'm not really too concerned about them. Looks like we had no sacks in this game, so that really was a difference maker, but we still come away with the victory. I don't know what I'm going to be looking to do right now because the trade deadline is fast approaching. I might want to boost up one side of the ball, probably offense, because that's where it seems like we're not scoring, or at least taking pressure off of Justin Fields. It seems like he's turning the ball over a little bit too much for me. Now, we do have a few upgrades after that week. It looks like Will Knowles might be superstar Trey because he has another upgrade, and that has been three so far this season in just five games. And looking at Jordan Nesvisky, who I think I'm going to end up trading here in this season. I think he's got good value. We've developed him really, really well. And here is another upgrade for Will Knowles. Let's upgrade that run stopper and get him up. He will upgrade a little bit, plus two in block shedding. Now he moves up to the number 35 ranked left end. He is developing really nicely. Lonnie Howard has an upgrade. I'm looking forward to seeing what he can do in the future. He was a guy we drafted 3 years ago. Let's just upgrade his man and see what he can at least give us some depth. We need some depth at every single position. That's important here in the simulation style of franchises that we run. And I am looking to see what we can do these next couple games. That will definitely tell if we're going to make a trade at the deadline. So let's see what we do against the Chargers. They're only 1-5. Wow, and look at this. We barely defeat the Chargers 14-10. I think it's pretty evident that we need another player on offense. And it looks like Kennedy Brooks will have an upgrade opportunity. Once again, he's at star development. He's already had one of these in his career. Now is his second one. He needs three touchdowns or 150 plus yards. I definitely do not see that happening. Looks like Keon Knight is a little bit frustrated. I'm not sure why he's frustrated, but let's just talk to him and see if we can get him back on track. And I think it's just because of the offense and the way Justin Fields is playing. We're not putting up points. And that's the one big thing. So let's get him five touches. I think that's doable, honestly. And let's see what player upgrades we have going into this week versus Kansas City, led by Patrick Mahomes. Now, Keon Knight, another upgrade for him. This will help going into this next week. Let's just upgrade that slot and just get his route running up a little bit. He is pretty much unguardable right now. And let's just look at his stats. At age 26, he's a number six ranked receiver in the league. And pretty much everything is at 90s now. He is a stopper. And look at that, KJ Hamler, another guy here. Let's just upgrade his slot as well. I think we might need to change the offensive scheme here in these sim situations because it seems like we're not passing the ball enough, getting it to our outside guys like Hamler, like Keon Knight. Well, before hopping into the Chiefs game, we get some unfortunate news. Will Knowles will be out 7 weeks, and the rookie he was doing pretty good at developing, and it looks like that will be cut short, and that will probably take him to the end of the season. I mean, he will be knocked out the rest of the year, probably until like week 15, week 16. He will probably return. So that sucks. So right before the trade deadline, let's see if we can take care of the Chiefs. And a tie, 17-17. And that kind of sucks. I was hoping to get another win right before the trade deadline. But now it seems like we need to get another offensive weapon. And it looks like Keon Knight did get his touches, and he gets 500 XP boost. And then also, let's see if we did get the breakout here, and we did not. Kennedy Brooks, that was kind of expected. I did not expect to get him that upgrade. So now that we are at the trade deadline, I'm looking at Jordan Nesvisky. Now, he had the opportunity to extend his contract in the offseason with a fifth-year option. We decided to decline that. And I think that it might be just time to move on and just go a new direction at defensive tackle. He isn't making a huge impact on this team. And you could just see his goals from each week. He had two tackles last week. He had a tackle the week before. Didn't even get a tackle at all that previous week. Nothing the previous week before that. Then he had four tackles. And, I mean, that's just the type of season he's having. So not really impactful. And I want to trade for a running back here. So the guy I'm looking at here, he plays for the Rams, and he is Everett. Let's just take a look at him, and let's just get a closer look. He's one of the top guys on the trading block right now, Trey Everett. He is 24 years old, out of Miami in his fourth season. He does have home run speed, 91 speed, 95 acceleration. I just need that impact guy, and he can also catch the ball really, really well out of the backfield. So let's just see if they will accept an offer for him. So they accepted straight up Everett for Nesvisky, and it looks like they got good value for the player. I think that we got good value as well. I'm going to start him right now because, like I said, I need to see some dynamic playmaking out of that running back position. I'm not seeing it right now out of Kennedy Brooks, and hopefully Trey Everett can make that impact. We'll see how he does. So in Everett's first two games, we end up splitting with the Eagles and the Packers. We lose to the Eagles 24-21 as they outscore us on offense. Definitely not the start we were looking for. And it looks like we barely ran the ball in this one at all. I mean, it looks like we didn't even run the ball at all with a running back. That is really, really surprising. I've never seen that before. Then in the second game, we give it to him 16 times 52 yards, and we end up with the victory. Fields throws for two touchdowns as we sweep the Green Bay Packers on the season. Actually, we do not. We split with them, and we just need to finish out this season strong. Let's see how we do over the next few games. Now, a dev trade opportunity for Trey Everett, who we just signed on the squad, and he needs two touchdowns or 100-plus yards receiving and or rushing. And here we go, going up against the Arizona Cardinals, who are 3-6. Let's just see if we get him his touches. We are on the road, and let's see if we come out with the victory. And we do, 26-21. Let's just look at the schedule here and see if we hit it here in the box score. I don't want to spoil it, opening up that message. Let's just see for ourselves. So we get 364 total yards gain, only 79 rush yards. So that may have told us right there. But let's see. He got 47 yards rushing, and he got not enough receiving. So he did not get that upgrade. But we do come away with the victory. KJ Hamler with a huge game, 11 receptions, 100 yards, and two touchdowns. That's a good victory and a good game, or good passing attack through the air, and I like that. Good victory. So over the next four games, we end up putting up some numbers on offense, starting with the Bears 36-24 victory, and Justin Fields has a career game, 5 touchdown passes over Mitch Trubisky's 2. And Trey Everett, he looks good right now, 16 attempts, 70 yards. I can't complain about that. But Keon Knight had himself a game, 7 for 149 and 3 touchdowns in that one. That's a good little victory there. But we did lose to the Seahawks, But let's just focus on our wins. 49ers, we beat them 25-22, and this was an ugly game, and we ended up winning. They literally doubled our offensive yardage in this one, 425 yards. But look at Fields. He threw three touchdown passes, 127 yards, zero interceptions. Joe Burrow, who plays for the San Francisco 49ers now, three touchdowns, three picks. And let's see, Everett. Everett did not move the ball well at all. But let's just see who had an interception on our team. Rich Patton, Vincent McLeod, and Lonnie Howard. And are we getting after the quarterback? We are not. James Anderson only had one. Nick Bosa had two sacks, but it's in a victory, so I'm not too mad. Then in the last game there, we do beat the Broncos by 7. And it looks like Justin Fields and Jake Fromm is on the Broncos now. And another solid rushing game for Trey Everett, but I'm looking for a 100-yard game. I wish he would get there. But Kennedy Brooks does bring us over 100, so we did get over 100 in this game. And then KJ Hamler had another big reception game, 8 for 91. So now with two games left on the season, we finish here 9-4-1, and hopefully we get to 11-4-1. And just looking at the rest of the NFC, we are right now in the divisional round, in the wild card round. Hopefully we do get a bye. We still could snag it. We need to finish out strong. But the Seahawks, who did beat us, they own the tiebreaker versus us. And just looking at, I just want to look at the rest of our division in the NFC North. And I believe it's usually like the same teams every year. Usually the Bears are up there with us, but this year it's the Vikings with us. And they have still not really made that leap with Trevor Lawrence at quarterback. And with two games left, we do take on the Bears and the Vikings. So let's just see how we finish out this season. And we're gonna tie. 28-28, pretty much an even game on offense here. Both quarterbacks threw for two touchdowns at least each. Justin Fields threw for four, so he's been catching fire lately at the end of the season. Trey Everett, we gave him 23 carries for 65 yards, and I've been looking to see if we get him involved in the passing game. We have not too much, and he's only had one reception for 4 yards in this one. But Keon Knight goes for 7 for 75. Man, KJ Hamler has been a really good number two this season. Two touchdowns for him. And let's look at defensively. We're not getting the sack totals that we're used to getting. We didn't even have any sacks in this one. Then to end the year, we do beat the Bears by 7 points, as we do outscore them on offense, out-total them on offense. Man, Fields is hot at the end of this year, and it looks like he threw for two touchdowns, no interceptions. Kennedy Brooks got into the game. Is that a bad sign? I don't know what, if Trey Everett is injured or anything. It doesn't look like he's injured, but Kennedy Brooks ran for 73 yards, and now we move on to the playoffs, as let's just see who we will face here in the playoffs, and we don't get the first round bye. And who do you know? We play the Vikings again. I mean, man, you cannot escape these divisional opponents. Seems like this whole franchise, it's just been all Bears and all Vikings. And the Bears we've been facing in the playoffs every single year, it seemed like, besides maybe the last two years. But the first like 5 seasons, we were facing them every single year in the playoffs. And now we face the Vikings. How fun. So next episode, I do want to resume this season with the playoffs, and I do kind of want to play the moments maybe in this playoffs. And let's just look at the totals here on the season. Justin Fields, 38-12, not a bad season at all. Another good season for him, but he had a slow start, and that's the only thing about him. But he is 90 overall. You cannot deny that talent he's got. Number 8 ranked quarterback in the league right now. We definitely have a quarterback, and I'm probably leaning towards signing him to a long-term extension. It seems like he's earned it, especially this year. Coming through late, and he hasn't disappointed with getting us to the playoffs. Now, our running backs have been disappointing, but I'm really hopeful for Trey Everett. He had a couple string of games. No 100-yard games, but I am encouraged because he is still young. 24 years old, 77 overall. Hopefully he can develop into something. But Kennedy Brooks is aging, and also, actually, you know what, he's still in his prime, but he's still not really having those explosive games. He is a number 22 ranked running back, so he is rated a lot higher than most running backs. but I've been looking for a lot more out of him. I am a little disappointed. He still has not had a 1,000-yard season at all. And just looking at everybody else, Lynn Burke got in a little bit. I liked him when I drafted him. And then Fields ran for 341 yards and two touchdowns of his own. Receiving-wise, we have two 1,000-yard receivers here. And looking at Keon Knight, he wasn't even our best receiver. KJ Hamler was. 96 receptions for 1,100 yards. That's a great season for him. And let's just look at KJ Hamler. 84 overall out of Penn State. Great speed. He's just a little shorter, but I don't care. I mean, he is a burner along with Keon Knight. These two provide a really good 1-2 punch. And then don't forget about Galladay in the slot. He had 577 yards and five touchdowns. And then add to that TJ Hockenson. How was our offense being stopped? I mean, it should be pretty much unstoppable. So let's just look at our offensive line. Who gave up a lot of sacks in this one? And that's Preston Myers, our right guard. But let's just look at Morris Thomas. He gave up 11 sacks on the season at left tackle. Quinn Bryant, my favorite guy in this entire series, maybe because he was our first draft pick. I am going to ink him to a new deal. He is the number three left guard in the NFL right now. Only gave up 3 sacks on the season. I really like what I saw from him and what I've seen from him the duration of this franchise. Now, James Anderson led our team in sacks with 9. Rich Patton led our team in tackles and interceptions, it looks like. Let's just verify that. Yeah, he did. Alonzo Allridge, who is our backup free safety, had 3 of his own. Ali Gray had 2 as well. Let's just look at the rest of the leading tacklers. Vincent McLeod, how is that possible? He had 2. He was second on the team in tackles over James Anderson, who was in there a lot. And Ali Gray, I'm surprised to see that for sure. Brian Ryan had 6.5 sacks. It seems like he hasn't been the same without Trey Flowers, but James Anderson has a career year. In terms of sacks, he is still one of the best outside linebackers in the game, and he does have an upgrade, so let's just upgrade him right now. He's up to 84 overall, and he goes up in man coverage and play recognition at 26 years old. He is the number 8 ranked left outside linebacker in the game right now. So I think that is enough here in this episode as we kick off the playoffs here at the start of next episode. Before hopping out of this one, let's just upgrade our last guys here. Ali Gray, who was one of our better draft picks here in this series, he's going to get an upgrade before the playoffs, going up to 86 overall, and he is the number 6 ranked strong safety, and we have a squad here on defense. And let's look at our other safety here, opposite of Ali Gray, and that is Carlos Wright. Let's put up his zone because I do want to see him get more interceptions. He goes up +2 in zone, and look at this, Carlos Wright, superstar trait. He is the number 9 ranked strong safety. It seems like we have top 10 guys at every position on defense. I really, really love that. And let's upgrade Michael Hunt, who has stepped up and is now the starting defensive tackle now. And he goes up to 71 overall, +1 in speed. I've never seen that before from a defensive tackle. He's at 79 speed now, 81 block shed, 77 finesse moves. So that is going to do it here in the episode, as the matchups are the Dolphins, Raiders, Buccaneers, Saints, Titans, Browns, and Vikings, Lions, as we look to maybe capture another Super Bowl as we went 10-4-2. Very rare to see 2 ties. The Redskins are on top once again in the NFC. That has been a reoccurring theme here. And then Andy Hope, who took over for Drew Brees, he is in the divisional round with the first round bye as well. And on the opposite side, the Texans, who are still quarterbacked by Deshaun Watson, and I believe the Jets are still quarterbacked by Sam Darnold, but who knows? I should probably take a look at that, and I'll probably highlight that to start the next episode. So you don't want to miss that. I am probably going to show a little bit of gameplay with the Vikings and Lions here as we do host this game. So it's going to be a good one. Hit subscribe. Hit that like button. Stay tuned. Let's get it. Let's go. Yeah, hey, filling out these job applications. Life got hard after high school graduation. I went to college and your boy got financial aid. They gave me money, then I went and bought a pair of J's. And I bought a pair of shades. And I bought a new computer. Half $100 left, spent the rest on...